Welcome to our live broadcast from the Mountain of God Tabernacle, high atop Mount Eagle Mountain, Tennessee. My name is Apostle Terry Dunn, and I'd like to tell you that we are a five-fold, full gospel, interdenominational church, which offers contemporary praise and worship, the teaching of God's Word, healing, deliverance, prophetic ministry, and much more. We are located in beautiful downtown Mount Eagle, Tennessee at 331 King Street. That's at the corner of King and 4th. Our Sunday morning worship service starts at 11:30 a.m. Central Standard Time, and everyone is welcome. Now, if for some reason you cannot attend our sanctuary, be sure to join our live stream at wildfireonthemountain.com. That physical address again is 331 King Street, or you can watch us live at www.wildfireonthemountain.com.
Good morning and welcome to Mountain of God Tabernacle. We're glad you joined us this morning by internet or DVD. We're going to start our worship service this morning with the sounding of the shofar. The Bible calls this the trumpet of the Lord.
and all the ways of man. You were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth.
Today I'm just going to go ahead and try to get into it real quick because it's a longer message than it was last week. Well, let's start off with a simple little prayer. Jesus, if the people who are receiving the message about the spiritual links is too young spiritually to understand these things, then please just blind them and give them absolutely no understanding to it. Even if they think that I'm absolutely crazy about this, that's perfectly fine. However, if they are spiritually old enough to understand these things, and please give them full understanding on it. And when I review things about the shields, please give them full understanding on the shields that they can protect themselves from Satan and from all of his demons. In the name of Jesus, amen. Now, if you have not seen my sermons on the cup model or on the decrees that I've done, I would encourage you to go ahead and actually take a look at them, because some of this may not make much sense. And honestly, trying to review all these various things and whatnot would take way too long in the midst of this message just to try to review them while you're going through it. But since there are quite a few people here, one of the things I am going to do is I'm going to review a very, very basic thing of the cup model. Now, you are a spiritual cup, and you get three different parts to it. You get sin, you get Jesus. I'm not very good writing with my left hand. And then you get you. And that's basically what's inside of your spiritual being, is three different parts. And what you want to do is you want to get to that point to where it's just you and Jesus. And that is what your spiritual cup model is. So when I refer to your cup, hopefully you got a slight vision of what it might actually be. Now, what I'm going to review today is I'm going to review spiritual links, and I'm also going to review shields. Now, first, I'm going to start off with spiritual links. Now, what are spiritual links? Well, spiritual links are links that allow you to transfer stuff that's inside of your spiritual cup to someone else's spiritual cup. And what do they transfer? The spiritual links can transfer all three different parts. The sin, the Jesus, and the self can be transferred. Now, let me give you an idea about spiritual links, what they kind of are. Well, first off, we have your cup and someone else's cup. Well, let's do some different colors. Spiritual link is almost like a water hose going from someone else's cup to your cup, or vice versa. Now, if you like it being, say, simple people, you and them, technically, it can be kind of like that. And that right there is a general idea of what the spiritual links look like. You got to remember that spiritual links are actually spiritual in nature, so you're not going to necessarily see them, not unless you have discernment on spirits. When a spiritual link is established from one person to another, your stuff in the midst of your cup can travel through. And one of those things that can travel through are demons. So demons can go from, say, this little person right here and travel around this little line to here and end up in the midst of this person here. So you got to be kind of careful with spiritual links. Now, how do you make spiritual links? That's the question. Well, one of the ways that you can make spiritual links is by the laying on of hands. This laying on of hands is something that creates a temporary spiritual link from one person to another. In 1 Timothy 5:22, it talks about how we should be careful about the laying on of hands. Now, the question is why? Well, most of us are probably taught about the demon issue, that the demons will jump onto you if you do laying on of hands. But what they don't teach about are the other things that can transfer. For example, your selfish nature can transfer from one person to another. And what's bad about that? Well, your own personal quirks and stuff can transfer to somebody else. And since you already have enough trouble dealing with yourself, you really don't want to deal with someone else's personality problems as well. Other things that you can transfer through spiritual links are generational curses. And one thing that you probably wouldn't consider is it could be dangerous to transfer spiritual gifts from one person to another. Because if you transfer a spiritual gift to somebody who is not ready for it, it could wreck them. For example, let's say that a person is brand new in their walk. You lay hands on them, and you transfer the gift of discernment onto the person. Well, the thing is, they might wake up the next day and find themselves seeing demons. Now, this could create a terrible nightmare situation inside of their mind and give them trauma from it. And then they pray not to have it again, and then they get scared with Christianity or whatever. That's a bad thing. Another thing you can consider is, let's say you lay hands on someone and pass the gift of healing to them. Okay, well, that sounds good. Well, the guy who gets the gift of healing, he goes out and can pray for people and they get healed. And what happens from then on? Well, he begins to realize that he's getting famous for it. People recognize him, so he ends up getting into a big ministry. And then it goes from doing things from God to doing things all about the money. And that gift of healing goes from being a gift that God uses for his kingdom to being a curse, which basically is going to put the guy in hell, whether you realize it or not. Another way that you can make a spiritual link is by asking God through prayer. Another way you can make a spiritual link is through faith. Another way that you can do it is through marriage. Now, marriage actually creates a permanent spiritual link between the two people who are married. I've heard rumors that it's possible that the spiritual cups actually combine into one when you get married. However, I'm not 100% sure on there. But I certainly do know that stuff from one married person to another married person can transfer. This is one of the reasons why you need to be real careful about being equally yoked to other people. If you end up getting married to somebody who is, say, a Satanist or something, all of their demons are going to jump on you, and it's going to be rough for you, especially if you cannot handle the amount of weight that those demons are going to put on you. I can remember a story of a girl who was a teenager, maybe early 20s, and what she did was she fell in love with a guy who was in prison. She eventually married him. Well, the guy in prison ended up getting saved. Well, that's a good thing. However, all his demons jumped onto the little girl and crushed her. And she went from being the girl who was in Sunday or at church every single Sunday to being a prostitute in the red light district. And I think she was on crack at the same time. So she got really crushed because she was unequally yoked. Another way to make a spiritual link is through sex. Sex creates a permanent sexual link. No, not sexual. Permanent spiritual link unto the other person until that spiritual link is actually severed. And if you're doing sex outside of marriage, then it's going to create an unholy spiritual link. One of the things to consider is Matthew 5:28, where it talks about how if you lust for a woman with your heart, you've already created adultery with her. Well, the thing is that it creates a spiritual link when you lust for another person, whether you're male or female, or lusting, for a male or female or dog, you're creating a spiritual link to them. So you got to be real careful about that. Here's something I actually want you to consider, and I'll do a little drawing here. And that is the spiritual state of America. All right. Let's say you got this little guy right here. He's addicted to porn, and what he does is he goes out and looks at a porn website, and he ends up seeing 5 different girls and creates a spiritual link to every single one of them. Well, the thing is he's not the only one who's actually viewing those girls. You got people over here who are doing the exact same thing. And in addition to that, this girl gets tons of spiritual links created to her through various people. And same with these other girls. They go all over the place. So, and you got tons of people who are spiritually connected to them. All right, we know that when we have spiritual links between each other, you can have demons transfer from one person to another through that spiritual link. Well, imagine if this guy right here has a demon of alcoholism on him. Well, that demon might actually have links to this girl right here. So So he comes over to this little girl who's in college trying to pay her tuition through porn or whatever. And it jumps on her. Then she gets alcoholism and becomes addicted to drinking alcohol all the time. Well, this little guy right here, he's already lusted for her. So you got a spiritual link in between there. So that little demon of alcoholism, if it really wanted to, it could have legal grounds to just go on to this guy right there. Now, here's the thing to consider. This guy right here is actually married to this woman right here, and you already got spiritual links to there. So that demon, once again, has legal grounds to go in from this guy right here to his wife. When you have a person who is addicted to porn, they don't just have like one or two spiritual links. They have thousands. So technically, when you get around to it, almost every single person in America is spiritually linked together in one way or another just because of porn. And that's a real bad thing. Yeah, you need lots of deliverance. Another way that you can make a spiritual link is through decrees. And what you do is you decree it through imagination and you push the decree through your heart. God sees what's inside your heart, receives it as a prayer, and it becomes as the thing that exists. Because God creates it. You can also create a spiritual link through contracts with demons. Now, usually your contracts with demons is something that a witch will do. Another way that you can create spiritual links is through eating foods sacrificed by idols. You might think that it's not really relevant today, but you might actually be surprised with how many people do actually eat food that are sacrificed to idols. Especially in the midst of the church. Another way that you can create spiritual links between people is through communion. Thing is me and my friends, we had to learn the hard way with the spiritual consequences of taking communion, especially with people who were not. Is that bad feedback? Okay. Who were not. Okay. Yeah, who were not actually born of the Holy Spirit. And the thing is that when you took communion with them, you had spiritual links amongst all the different people. So you ended up sharing in the sins with everyone else. And that was something that we had to learn the hard way. My friend ended up going to a church and not everybody there was born of the Holy Spirit. Not everybody there was really dedicated. Someone probably addicted to porn. And he was a guy who was trying to aim to be higher in God, but yet he was taking communion with them every few Sundays or whatever. And he just found himself constantly in the midst of sin, and he asked God about it, and God told him, well, you're in the midst of communion, and you're partaking in everyone else's sins. And we're like, ooh, that's a real bad thing there. In the early days, when you go back and read the information that the early Christians wrote back in, say, the 1 or 200s, those Christians refused to take communion with anyone who was not born of the Holy Spirit. And we should be practicing the same things these days, too. Now, there's probably more ways that you can make a spiritual link. Either A, I didn't really know of it at the time, or I just didn't remember. But if there are more, let me know. One thing to understand is that spiritual links can transcend space. Links are not limited to close proximity. I mean, a person doesn't have to be standing right next to me with me laying on in hands just to be able to create that spiritual link. The spiritual links can be of any distance. For example, I can create a spiritual link from right here to somebody who's in China. You got to remember that spiritual links are spiritual, not physical. Therefore, physical limitations on spiritual links do not exist. Only spiritual limitations exist on spiritual links. Spiritual links can also transcend time. Now, this is an interesting concept, so I'll draw a little bit of stuff here about how time can work. All right, let's assume that this is time right here. Time is more or less like a spiritual container that contains events. In the Bible, it says that God is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the beginning and the end. What you got to remember is that God exists at the beginning of time, and he also exists before it, and he also exists at the end of time, and he exists after it, and he exists everywhere outside of time as well. Another thing to consider is that God not only exists outside and around time, and that before the beginning and after the end, he also exists in the middle of time too. So, since God is going to be the one who creates our spiritual links for us, we can be this little person who's down here, standing on earth, and we can technically take our little spiritual link, go into time, go to the left a little bit, and find Apostle Paul, who died almost 2,000 years ago, and connect to his cup. Or if you don't like going that direction, you just go that direction. And what can you do? You can take the stuff that's out of Apostle Paul's cup and bring it into yours, like the healing or the other various gifts that he had. You can create a link to Apostle Paul almost 2,000 years ago and be able to get those spiritual gifts out of him, because it's God who's creating these spiritual links. Another thing to consider is that we're talking about something that's in the midst of the spiritual. Apostle Paul may not physically exist on earth, but is he completely gone from existence? No, he exists in the third heaven. And we're doing things in the midst of the spiritual realm, not in the midst of the earth realm. Who else is alive or still exists that has been dead for thousands of years? Goliath. However, Goliath is in the midst of hell. But you don't want to create any spiritual links to him, because that's, you know, telling what you're going to get from that guy. Now, there are some warnings that you got to be aware of when it comes to spiritual links. You are responsible for what you pass to somebody or what you take from someone else's cup. If you pass, say, demons and generational curses or whatever, you're going to be judged for it. However, on the other side, if you're passing things like spiritual gifts and Jesus onto people and it helps build God's kingdom, you're going to be rewarded for such a thing. Now, how do you protect yourself from spiritual links? One way that you can do this is through prayer. If you already have unholy spiritual links on you, you can cover them with the blood of Christ and sever them with the sword of the Spirit. And another way to do it is through shields. Now, this right here actually concludes the thing for spiritual links. If anybody has any quick questions, I can try to answer them. Yay, nay. Can you link to anybody who is a leader? Yes, you can link to anybody who is leader. Everybody has a spiritual cup. Therefore, if they have a spiritual cup, you can link to them. You want to take a mic and no? Yeah, I want to... Yeah, if the pastor is actually addicted to porn and they're taking communion with everyone else, you're going to create a lot of spiritual links with them, and there's no telling what's going to happen to your congregation. Let's put it that way. And supposedly, according to the statistics, about 50% of pastors are addicted to porn. So, yeah. Yeah, really bad, defiled America. All right. Shields. Now, shields is how you protect yourself in the midst of the spiritual realm from demons and people putting stuff into your cup and stuff like that. What I'm going to do right now is just give you a whole bunch of Bible verses just so I can get them out of the way real quick and show you that shields are actually in the midst of the Bible. First, you got Psalms 18:2. This talks about how God is your shield. You also got Proverbs 30, verse 5. This talks about how God shields those who trust in him. Then you have Job 1:10, which talks about how God made a shield that Satan could not get through. technically it says God put a hedge around them, but a hedge is actually a shield. Then you get Psalms 18:30, which said that God is a shield to those who trust him. Then you have Proverbs 2, verses 7 through 8, which says that God is a shield to those who walk upright. Remember that. You got to walk upright to get your shield. Another one, which may not be that clear, but I'll give you some explanation, is Mark 16, verses 17 through 18. Now, this set of verses talks about how serpents and poison will not hurt you. This is actually a real good example of a verse in the Bible that shows you the outcome of something, but it does not show you what's going on behind the scenes. Your serpents are usually, in the midst of the spiritual realm, going to be demons that are attacking you from the outside. Poison that you consume, that's pretty much demons going on the inside of your body. And when you look at the thing or look at the verse and you see that you're being protected from serpents and poison that you consume, you're actually looking at the simple fact that the person has shields on the outside of the body and shields on the inside of the body. It's a both inner and outer shield. Then you got Ephesians 6, verse 11 through 18. Now, this talks about the armor of God. And it mentions that faith, it mentions that shield is a shield of faith. One of the reasons why you have to have faith for a shield, or why shield is a faith shield, is because you cannot see the shield. Therefore, you have to have faith to know that your shield is up. Now, God will provide shields for you, but this is going to be limited to a few various factors and whatnot. Number one, it's going to be limited to how much sin you have. It's going to be limited to your faith. It's going to be limited to what you ask for. It's going to be limited to how you visualize your shield. And it's going to be limited to how much of the all you actually surrender to Jesus. Now, I'm going to review each and every one of those in a little bit more depth. The sin limitation. If you got sin, then demons have legal grounds to get through your shields. So God's going to let them through. If you're addicted to porn, then all your porn demons of like fornication, adultery, lust, all those things are going to be allowed to get through. However, demons like alcoholism and, say, theft won't be able to get through your shields because you don't have an open door to that. The broken heart, the spiritual broken heart, is another thing that can actually lead to holes in the midst of your shield. For example, let's say that you had a person who was abused during their childhood. Well, this causes the spiritual broken heart in the midst of them. And because they have that, they usually will have open doors of things such as anger, revenge, sometimes even murder. And because of that, because the spiritual heart is broken, it does open up the holes inside of the shield to allow those demons to come in. That's one of the reasons why it's really important to go in and heal the spiritual broken heart when you're doing deliverance. Another thing that can open doors or holes into your shield is the self part of your cup. And this is like your likes or dislikes, stuff like that. For example, if you really like your cigarettes, then the demon of addiction has direct access to go through your shields onto you. If you really like your TV show, then any demons that come with that are legal to come into you. The faith limitation. If you believe or you have faith that you have a really weak shield, then trust me, you really do. If you have faith that you have a really strong shield, then it's going to be strong. God will make it strong for you. If you believe that demons can go through your shields, God is going to let them through. If you don't believe that your shields are real, then God ain't going to give you any. However, out of grace, he might still give you some anyways. But if he doesn't give them to you and you don't have faith for him, that's probably the reason why. the what you ask for limitation. If you do not ask, you will not receive. If you don't ask for certain shields, you're not going to get them. You're going to get what you ask for. The visualization limitation. Your shield is going to manifest around you basically how you visualize it to be. For example, if you visualize that your shield is going to be nothing but a little thing that goes around your arm, like you see in some of the movies, then you're pretty much just going to get a shield like that. If you get a, let me erase this real quick. All right, if you visualize your shield as being something that surrounds you like a little bubble, then that's what you're going to get. How much of all you actually give to Jesus? Well, it talks about in the Bible how we have to give up our lives in order to receive eternal lives. Let me give you a basic concept of what your life is. You know how somebody says, I have a life? Well, that's your life that you're going to have to give up. How much of everything that you've done in life, everything that you've worked for, are you willing to give up your family? You're willing to give up your kids? Willing to give up your house you just paid for? What are you willing to give for Christ? The more you're willing to give, the more he's going to protect you from Satan. Now, there's about 7 different levels or so of shielding. And you can take what you want from it. You can believe what you want. This is kind of how God related things to me and to other people as well. And it works well for me, whether it works well for you. Good question. He might reveal shields to you in a different way. But I'll reveal to you what I understand. The level one shield. The level one shield is kind of like a little bubble shield. What I'm going to do, I'm going to show you a little example of something. Oh, did your computer freeze? Windows 10 normally has freezing. Oh, well. All right, anyways. Your little bubble shield is kind of an interesting little shield that exists. On the level one level, what happens when you get in to 2 different people and they both have little bubble shields, when they get close enough, these little shields will actually combine into one little shield. So, and then you have both people inside of it, which is kind of neat. But the problem with the little bubble shield is the simple fact that if a person has demons on them or whatever, the demons exist inside this shield, so they can jump from him, fly onto you. So you got a real issue with that one. Yeah, minor technical difficulties. Actually, I might be able to fix this. Okay. Well, hopefully I'll get back to it soon. All right. Well, this is a problem with the basic level one shield. So we don't really want a level one shield. Instead, we want a shield that's a lot stronger that's not going to allow demons into the midst of our shield. So what you end up having is a level 2 shield, which is a hard bubble shield. And when somebody gets into the midst of your area, what it's going to do, it's going to take their demons, and it's actually going to push their demons off and keep it outside of your hard bubble shield. The problem with your level 2 shield is that it's breakable. The reason why it's breakable is because demons, when they're on the outside of it, they're going to constantly attack it with whatever weapons they can find. And as soon as they make a little crack inside of it, they're going into you. Even if you take a diamond and you sit there and you attack the thing with the right weapons and for long enough, eventually it's going to get a crack and break. Same thing with that little shield. Oh, did I go through? Oh. Yeah, minor technical difficulties for those who are on MP3. All right, cool. I'm going to go through. Awesome. All right, let me give you an idea of shield number one. All right, now this right here is a little example of someone who has a level one or level two shield around them. You have the little demons or whatever going in trying to attack the person, but they're just bouncing off simply because they're hitting the shield. What you might notice is a simple little fact that it's actually invisible and you can't see it. That's why it's a shield of faith. And then as soon as the thing hits it, you actually see the shield manifest. That's just a basic example. All right. Cool thing with shields is that shields are not limited to just shields around you. If you want to make them more powerful, one of the things that you can do is you can put rings of fire around them. Now, where's rings of fire in the Bible? Well, look at Zechariah 2:5. This is where it says God is a wall of fire around Jerusalem. And because of that, what we can do is if we get a simple little shield that we are surrounded with, say like that, what we can do is we can have a ring of fire that goes across it. And when demons go into that wall of fire, what happens is they begin to get burned. And it hurts real bad, so they don't want to stay there very long trying to attack your shield. But eventually, the shield will break. So that is a problem. There was a guy who actually did the rings of fire around his shield, and he complained to God one day and said, okay, how can I have something that's better? This doesn't hold up very well. And what God had revealed to him is pray for angels of fire to come in. And what happened was God sent in angels that would run rings of fire and constantly replenish the fire rings that was around the shield. Now, us, we might just think, oh, we just have a simple little ring of fire around it. Well, imagine if you got a ring that goes this way, one that goes that way, one that goes that way, one that goes that way. I mean, just as if you had a little ball of yarn and you look at each little yarn strand and each one of those strands represents a little ring. Well, you end up with a set of rings of fire like that going around your shield. It's going to last a pretty good long time because if a demon gets in it and that fire begins to fade away, well, the angel is going to come back around, run over the top of it, and set it back on fire again. And then the shield lasts a little bit longer. And that's when you get to, say, level 2.75 shields. However, level 3 shields. Level 3 shields are actually something that's very important to understand. And that is understanding that shields can be of any shape and any size. Now, Terry, you might want to put the camera up there, so they can get all of it. That right there shows a picture of a little rectangle shield. You see all the various people inside of it. It's a lot easier when you have visual representations of shields. That right there is another shield, but completely different from the original, but still allowing for squares being in the midst of it. Another one is a shield that's over the midst of a house. And you can see it has other little barriers coming out the side of it and stuff like that. So not only are you limited to shielding yourself, you can also shield buildings and other things as well. Now, let me draw you a simple little example of something. All right, put a shield around that. That's fairly simple to do. All you really got to do has envisioned the shield goes around every single one of these little lines right here, all the way through it. Continue on with the envisioning. Then ask God to do it, and he can shield something that complex. It's not limited to just a real little bubble or a square or something like that. It can be any shape, any size you want. What's important about that? You can make the shield the shape and size of your body, meaning you can have a skin-tight shield. Remember the problems with the little bubble shield? Well, if demons get inside of your little bubble, what are you going to do? Well, if your shield is on your body, then they have to break that shield before they can even attach to you or even do anything to you. All right, level 3.5 shields. These are the shields that I use my own personal self. They are shields with purpose, and they're a little bit more complex than normal. All right, imagine that you got a shield with multiple shields in the midst of it. And what happens is a shield will get created right here. And then after that is created, it will go in and push every single one of these shields outward really hard, really fast. And the last shield will end up disappearing after the new one's created. And then it'll go in and it'll create a new shield. And then it'll go in and do that. And it'll erase the last shield. Meaning that it has a whole bunch of layers of shields that are constantly repairing itself. So if demons attack this layer right here, who cares? It's going to be gone in less than 1 second anyways. And a new one's going to be created for it. In addition to that, it also gives repelling power. So if a demon comes in and tries to hit it with a baseball bat, then what's going to happen is that baseball bat's going to just repel off the shield. Imagine if you had a Ferrari coming at you at, say, 200 miles per hour. Then you take a baseball bat and say, ooh, I'm just going to hit it as it goes by. What's going to happen? You're going to end up really hurt. That's what's going to happen to you. Same concept with the demons. But my shield actually goes a little bit further. If a demon touches the shield, then what happens? Let me draw a little frog creature here. If a demon decides to go in and touch my shields, then what's going to happen is this shield is going to shoot inside of the demon and spike all over its body. And then after that, it's going to set it on fire real quick, while at the same time repelling it to somewhere else. Now that brings up another point. Shields can be weapons as well. In the old days, they would put spikes on their shields, and when they didn't have their weapons around, they'll just hit people in the heads with it, you know, cause them a lot of damage. Your spiritual shields can also be weapons. And mine is a weapon that they don't want to touch at all. Not only is it hard to break through, but they also get to be caught on fire and enjoy tons of pain. Another thing that you can do, if you really wanted to, you could put spikes all over your shield, so that if they decide to run into it, they get impaled. Well, the thing is they can come in between the spikes. So in order to prevent them from coming in between the spikes, you make it rotate. You can cause your shields to rotate if you really want them to. At which point in time, it's like sending them into the midst of a blender. Yeah, you don't want to touch that. Oh, yes, that reminds me. Another thing that's important. Over here and find it. Oh, that doesn't work. Oh, it does. All right. This person right here, what she is doing, she is creating a temporary little shield that's in the front of her. You can see the size increases and it also decreases in size. You can do the exact same thing with your shields, too. You can also notice that it moves with her. Your shields will move with you. Then you get this next example, whenever it decides to come up, if it does. Oh well. Anyways, on to level 4 shields. Oh, yeah, it did time out. Oh, there it goes. Okay, here we go. All right, you can see that the shield, the first shield that we saw was only like maybe the size of her upper body. This shield actually goes in and becomes almost twice her size. And then you see the little snake demons trying to come in and attack her, but they just bounce off as soon as she puts up her shield. You can do the exact same things if you want to with your shield. The reason why I give you these examples is because if you see it, it's a lot easier to imagine and envision your shield. And that allows you to degree them into existence a lot easier. Now, all these things are actually used under the midst of the free use clause of 501c3 for educational purposes only. So we can't be sued for such things. I'll put that little disclaimer in there. All right. Level 4 shielding. Level 4 shielding is what is known as the anti-witchcraft shield. If you remember when I was talking about decrees, one of the things that you can do with people with your words that you say is that you can curse them from the things that you say. And this shield right here will protect you from the other curses that people put on you. And it'll actually protect them from the curses that you put on them. Now, level 5 shielding is finally when we get to the point to where your shields are permanent and don't just randomly fall off or get broken through. The level 5 shield is kind of silver in color, and it's just as if Jesus poured his blood all inside of you and on the outside of you and baked it until it became a silver color. And it's one of the shields that's both inside and outside of the body. It's the thing that protects you from both the serpents, and from the poison. The thing is that in order to receive a level 5 type shielding, you're going to have to ask for it, and you're going to have to be walking upright with God. You need to have no sin in your cup and as very little of you in your cup as possible in order just to get to that level 5. Level 5.5 shield. Now, this is a shield that exists that protects you from other people's leviathans. Leviathan is known in the Bible as the strong delusion that God sends upon the people. And probably one of the most difficult demons to ever deal with. The only way to get it off of you is through repentance. You can plead the blood of Christ on you, and it laughs at you. You have to do repentance because God put it there. And God will shield you from other people's leviathans if you're walking upright with God. The level 6 shield. This is a gold color shield, and it's something that you obtain once you submit yourself to God's perfect will. You have to give up your noble birthright in order to receive this type of shielding. It will protect other people and you from your subconscious desires, which can also be curses upon people too. After you end up getting this shield, you'll usually go through a transition period. And what this transition period is when God rearranges your life to be in the midst of his perfect will. And what's going to happen when he does that? God is going to remove everything that he didn't want you to have. Your life pretty much will flip upside down. Everything you worked for in life, you're going to lose it all. Just to understand the concept of perfect will versus permissible will is pretty difficult, and I could do an entire sermon on it and may not be able to get it all across, but I'll try to give you some very basic understandings just so you can, hopefully you can understand why you'll end up losing everything when you transfer yourself into the midst of God's perfect will. Now, this is the difference between perfect will and permissible will. Permissible will is what God allows you to do and to have. However, God's perfect will is what God wants you to do and wants you to have. When you enter into the midst of God's perfect will, God will rearrange everything from what was allowed to the exact way that God wanted it. Everything that was allowed but was not in line to God's perfect will is removed. Now, what I'm going to try to do is just give you a basic example of, say, a couple of questions of where God gives answers for permissible will and God gives answers for perfect will. All right, question number one. You go in and ask God, can I hire a prostitute? In the midst of God's permissible will, he may say, you can, but prepare for the consequences. However, you ask God, should I hire a prostitute? And God says in the midst of his perfect will, absolutely not. Now, if you think the prostitute thing might throw you off a little bit, here's something to consider. You had, I do believe it was Amos, that God told to go in and marry a prostitute. Hosea? Okay, thank you for correcting me. Couldn't remember some of my names. So Hosea was told to go out and marry the prostitute. Now, let me give you another scenario that will kind of go forth and give you an idea between permissible will and perfect will. All right, God tells Ted to go to Africa to evangelize the pygmies. Now, he also tells Ted that he's going to be uncomfortable, he'll never see a toilet again, got to sleep in the dirt, and it's just going to be a disaster with him getting sick with malaria and stuff like that. Well, Ted goes in and asks God if he can preach at a local church. God goes ahead and allows this. During Ted's life, he saves 1,000 people, which is pretty good. However, if Ted had gone to Africa, he would have saved 100,000 people instead. Since Ted didn't go, on Judgment Day, he ends up guilty of 100,000 people who go to... No, wait. He ends up guilty of 99,000 people who went to hell. The reason why is because he saved 1,000, but 100,000 went to hell, so he has a deficit of 99,000. Come Judgment Day, if you want to believe it or not, that's okay. God's going to judge based off of his perfect will compared to what you did in life. So he looks at his perfect will and says, all right, you should have done all this, but yet you completed it this way. And what you did in accordance to his perfect will, he gives you rewards for what you did. Not in the midst of his perfect will, you get judged for. God's permissible will was allowing Ted to teach at the church or to become a preacher at the church. God's perfect will was for Ted to go to Africa. Now, my question for you is what's worse, being responsible for, say, 99,000 people going to hell or hiring a prostitute? That's something you can just randomly think about on your own time. Anyways, back to shields. 11-7 shield. After the transition period, if you happen to make it through and you still continue on, going on with life, dedicating your life to Jesus, you'll end up receiving the final shield that exists. And this is kind of like a white shield that's made out of light. It is basically the shield that Jesus himself had. Completely impenetrable. It's as good as it gets. You'll never have to have another shield put around you again because God protects you 100% because you are in the midst of God's perfect will. This is pretty much at the point to where God himself keeps you from sinning. Now, you want some Bible evidence of it? Look at Deuteronomy 5:29, where it talks about how God will keep you from sinning. Now, my question for you is what level shielding are you at? And what level shielding do you want? Now, if you want to get better shielding to protect you from the demons and stuff like that, then you need to remove the red stuff from your cup. Then, after you get the sin out of you, you need to go forth and ask Jesus, what parts of me do you not like? Crucify me, Lord. get the stuff out that's my personality that you don't like. That's the thing you got to do afterwards. Then you can prepare yourself to get the higher level shieldings and to move up in Christ. Now, how do we put shields up? Well, one of your traditional ways, or what I call traditional, is you say your shield prayers every morning. The DiSapios actually left us with shield prayers. And they work. I'm not going to say anything bad about them. They do work. They give you something like level 2, level 3 shields or so. But I don't really care for them. And that's because they take too long. You can easily spend 5 to 15 minutes trying to recite one of those things out, especially if it's one or two pages long. Me, I prefer to decree the shields into existence. And as for me, I can put up my shields within a few seconds by using decrees. And I put on somewhere around 1 trillion shields or so, because I shield every single one of the cells inside of my body, and the average number of cells that an adult has is about 1 trillion. So that's, I have a little bit more shielding than that, but that's about how many shields I put up within a few seconds. If I'm having a bad day and I'm under oppression from Satan and I have blocking spirits, it could take me a couple of minutes. Now, here's something I want you to consider about using decrees for shields. All right, let's do another pictorial thing. All right, you got God who's in heaven. You imagine a shield being a certain shape and size, right? Well, God already knows your thoughts. Inside your heart, you say inside your heart, I want that shield right there that I just imagined. Well, God also knows what's inside your heart, so he recognizes it as a prayer and then gives you that shield. And if you can think fast enough and decree it fast enough, then God will put it up in that instant. Now, there's a few different things that you need to consider when you're doing the defining of a shield through the imagination. Number one, you're going to need to define its color, define its position, its purpose, its shape, and how it works. Now, I'm going to go over each and every one of those real quick. Color, hopefully, is self-explanatory. You saw in the midst of there, you had yellow shields. Well, you can have white shields, purple shields, gold shields, red shields. It doesn't really matter. Any color you like, you can have a shield of that color. But we must understand what's really important is positioning. You got to remember that we exist in the midst of a 3D space, and your demons are going to attack you from a 3D space. So, if you imagine yourself with just a little buckler or something like that around your arm to protect you, then literally God's just going to give you a little buckler around your arm to protect you. And if a demon decides to come on your back, literally you're going to have to move your arm like this just to protect them, to protect yourself from getting hit by the demon. If it's coming on your legs, you're going to have to do this. And as you walk around all day long, you're just going to have to do this, and people are going to think you're absolutely crazy. Yeah, Ninja Turtle. Now, if you imagine that you end up getting one of those really big shields like they have, say, from the Roman soldier days that protect the entire person, that's great. The demons come in, they hit this thing, they bounce off. However, they're going to attack you from behind. So you have to put up a shield from behind. Well, that prevents them from attacking from behind. But what are they going to do? They're going to go around to your sides. And they're going to attack you from the sides. They got to put up shields from the sides. Then what are they going to do? They're going to say, oh, okay, we can't enter from those four sides, so we're going to go through the top. Well, you put a shield on the top. Well, they say, okay, that's fine. We'll just go on through the bottom. They got to put one on the bottom. Well, instead of having that many complicated shields, why not just go in and create yourself a little simple bubble shield that protects it all 360 degrees? That's a lot easier than trying to just put up a whole bunch of Roman shields all around you or something like that. You also need to go in and define the purpose of your shield. What is your shield going to protect you from? Well, if you don't want demons to see you, then you make the shield so that the demons can't see through it. And that is called a cloak. Me, I ended up creating a few various shields that had different purposes and reasons. One day, I was doing some computer work over at somebody's house, and the lady ended up being a stripper. Well, she had a demon of seduction on her. Well, that demon would sit there and attack my heart. So what did I do? I created a little black-like shield that's almost like a Kevlar plate and ended up over my heart to protect the little demon from attacking me. Because seduction is nothing but a little snake that kind of stands out underneath someone's chin and they just randomly reach out and attack their heart or whatever they need to do in order to get people seduced. Well, that was pretty good because it protected my heart. However, I found out that the seduction demon could also hypnotize you through its eyes. So I said, okay, that's interesting. So what did I do? I put on a visor that prevented the hypnotizing from the snake. And what happened when I went back to her house? Oh, looky there. It didn't affect me here. It didn't affect my eyes. It didn't do any of that. Complete and total shielding from it. That was pretty nice. After which point in time, it found another way around, and it started talking to the demon of lust. And, well, if you get rid of the demon lust out of you, it has nothing else that it can do. So it worked well for me. Another little shield that I made was something to protect from the demon of sloth. The demon of sloth is just a huge, well, the principality, one of them here, is a demon of sloth. It's nothing but a huge sloth in the midst of the spiritual realm that's a few stories tall. It'll go in and it will put people to sleep. Well, sometimes you might recognize after you eat a big dinner or something like that, you get real sleepy. Well, that's not because you consumed excessive carbs. It's because usually some type of demon is trying to put you to sleep. And usually it's going to be sloth who's trying to put you to sleep. And what I found out was the principality up here, it sees that you eat a big meal, so it creates a little spiritual link to you and then tries to put you to sleep through that. So I created a specific shield to protect against sloth and his little spiritual links. And whenever I put the shield up, it would instantaneously remove those spiritual links so he couldn't affect me anymore. So I remember one day I was eating with the family on Thanksgiving, and I ended up having my big meal, and a few minutes later, I began to feel tired. Well, I decreed that shield into existence, the anti-sloth shield, and seconds later, I was no longer sleepy. And I wasn't sleepy for as long as that shield was on. So you certainly can make shields for different purposes. You also need to define its shape. If you want it to be a little bubble thing, that's great. If you want it to be, say, the shape of your body, that's even better. But remember, you're not restricted to, say, a little bubble or a little square or something like that. You can make it any shape, any size. And if you need to, describe or think of how it works. My shielding that I use is kind of complex, but you don't have to have something that complex. You can just think, oh, I just need a shield that protects me from the demon. And that's all it really needs to do. After you imagine and define what your shield's going to do, you just decree it in your heart. God sees it, and he puts it into effect. Now, here's the important thing. How do we shield from spiritual links? Well, one of the things that you can do, that you can imagine a shield that's around your spiritual cup. Or you can just imagine a shield that's around you that has a sole purpose of preventing other people's spiritual links from hitting you or connecting to you. Or, if you really want another shield, which I've used a lot, let's say we're doing laying on of hands and say my arms hurt, right? Well, let's say someone comes in and lays their hands on my arm. Well, what I can do is I can put a shield in between their hands and my forearm. and that prevents them from transferring anything bad to me. Now, you need to give it a purpose. And what is the purpose of your shield going to be? The purpose is to be a filter. You only want the Jesus coming out of someone else's cup. So you filter out their sin, and you filter out their personal works that they have and their personality or whatever. Filter all that out, and you only allow the Jesus to come into you. And make it so that it's both ways, not just one way. So you can't transfer your demons onto them either. Now, let's say you got somebody over here who's in China, and you create a little spiritual link to them. What you could do is you could imagine something like a little shield that's right in the middle of it that acts like the filter that prevents all the red stuff, which is sin, from going in, and all the yellow stuff, which is you, I don't have a yellow marker, so it'll have to be blue, from going out, and it'll go vice versa. I've done that too. It's helped out. So just to remind you, God might reveal this in a slightly different way, but this is how I've learned it. And if you have learned it in a different way, that's perfectly fine. God's going to relate to everyone differently. Practicing shields or putting them up, it's going to be a daily thing. I went through having to use shields for more than a year before I finally got to this point. I've been using shields for almost 2 years now, and I've just advanced pretty fast with it. But I've gone through a lot of experimentation. It's like, all right, let's try this kind of shield and see what happens. Well, that didn't work. Let's try that. Let's try this. And eventually I got to the point where I said, okay, cool, this stuff works, and this doesn't, so let's forget about it. Now, if there's any questions, I can try to answer them. Yeah, I'll give them to you afterwards. Yep. Yeah, one of the things that you certainly can do is you can shield your cars and stuff like that, and that can help protect a whole bunch of things. And God certainly will send his angels if you do get in a car accident. He can prevent all the damage to your car. Well, my question for you is, since you've already seen some of the stuff in the midst of the scripture, has this helped clarify anything for you? A little bit, yeah. Mm-hmm. You're welcome. That actually, one of the things I was reminded of is what I actually do with this church with shields. Well, what I do is I put my shielding in three different ways around the entire church. And this little part's the parking lot. And I don't just have one shield around it. I actually have three of them. It doesn't look that bad, but I'm just trying to make it easy. And the thing is I use multiple levels of shielding. First, on the outside of here, you got the various thing. Let's see, what are they called? Mine went blank. Oh, well, it's a whole bunch of fires. The firewall that goes around this thing. All right, we're going to call this Shield 1, Shield 2, and Shield 3. Well, in between Shield 1 and Shield 2, if the demons manage to break through this shield, they're going to get struck by lightning a whole bunch of times. Then, if they still manage to break through this thing, then they get hit by something called Chi Sakura, which is one of my weapons. Then, if they manage to get through that, they're going to be in pieces and burned and shocked in horrible ways. So, just to be able to get through my shield on this church, they got to travel through a lot. Not only that, it's also below ground. The shields go below ground. If you do put up shields around your house or whatever, make sure you put them below ground too, as well as above ground. That reminds me of another thing that exists. Shields can also protect you from witches who astro project. Your shields can keep out the witches who attempt to astro project into you or into your house or whatever. You can also put up cloaks and stuff around your where you live or your buildings or your car or whatever. And those witches who are flying overhead through astral projection are not going to be able to see it because they are in the same kind of limitations that demons are when they're doing astral projection. So your shields will protect against the witches who astral project. Oh, okay. Yeah, Leviathan, that's a very special demon that exists that the Father himself sent. It's not something that's sent by the Son. And you got to remember that although the Father and Son and Holy Spirit is one, they're also separate at the exact same time. In the midst of Job, it specifically tells us that the only way we can get rid of Leviathan is through repentance. I've known deliverance ministers who's tried to go in and get rid of Leviathan through attacking them or pleading the blood of Christ over them or something like that. And all it did was get them under Leviathan. Leviathan didn't go away. However, someone who had the gift of repentance had to come in and repent for that person just to be able to get out from under it. Leviathan is a special type of demon that exists. He's one of a kind. He's the only one that exists like this. But the only way to get rid of them is through repentance. You have to repent of your sins, and then the Father, not the Son, will release it from you. That's almost a whole sermon in itself just to try to define those things. But that's how I know the thing works. You can attack it with weapons. You can plead the blood of Christ over it. It just gets you under the demon. But it's a very specialized demon that exists. And it's the only one of its kind. The blood of Christ works on everything else, you know. But that one, that's just something that God sent when people became full of pride and thought that they knew everything, like the Pharisees. They thought they knew everything, but they were actually given a Leviathan. And you don't come out from under it, not unless you repent. And you come out from your sins, though. Yeah, you got to be able to have forgiveness of your sins in order to help get those demons off of you and stuff. But yeah, you're talking about tormenting demons in the midst of, what was it, John? James. It was in the midst of James. The torment is a very interesting word in the midst of Greek. It means to torture, or it comes from a set of words that include torturing. So, was it resist or torment? Oh, resist, my bad. Okay, I get confused, sorry. Some things happen like that. All right, resist Satan and he shall flee. Okay, my bad. Got it confused with something. All right, resist. When we think of resist, we think of it as, oh, I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to turn my head the other way and go something like that. No, resist, in the midst of the Greek, actually means to attack. So this gets into, say, my next version of the sermon. When a demon comes up to you, what you do is you take a sword and you poke its eye out, and it's going to run away. That's what it means to resist a demon. You resist them physically in the midst of the spiritual realm. You hit him as hard as you possibly can with whatever spiritual weapon you got, and it's going to run away from you. You want to get demons off of people faster? You torture them. You poke them in the eye with a sword. You set them on fire or something like that, and they're more likely to run away and get away from that person because they don't like being hurt. They're cowards. So that's part of my next message. Don't worry. Anything else? No? Okay. I'll just go ahead and pray. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you for teaching us all about the shields that you've revealed to us over the years and things that I've been able to learn and be able to teach other people. Thank you for teaching us how to protect ourselves from the demons and Satan himself. Please do teach us individually how to use shields and how to do more with shields. And please remind us to put up our shields every single day. And please lead us closer to you. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Father, we just come to you and we thank you today for your word, Father, for your revelation. Something new every day, Father, you're so.
Thank you for joining our live broadcast here from the Mount of God Tabernacle. We hope to see you soon, and may you have a blessed day in the Lord Jesus Christ.